lovely invitation. I'm really happy to be here and that this opportunity came up. And I think it's also kind of a sign that many people are working now with that. It's not just a buzzword, algorithms, of course, it's a buzzword. It's all over the news, and there's barely a day where there's no news about something that has to do with the new frontiers of algorithms. But also, I think that there's some really interesting new research that connects algorithms and the arts. And so today I will talk about this project that is actually, it is still something like a seed project because we just started this spring. Me and my colleague David Perot, we're both based in Graz in Austria. And this is an interesting research scheme that is specific to Austria. It's called PEK, Program for Arts-Based Research. So they have a dedicated program for arts-based research. And this project will run now for roughly three more years. There's also a couple of people that are kind of on the periphery of this project. I've listed them below there, so you can see there's sound artists, composers, curators, theoreticians, and people from the arts-based research environment. And I will talk about the structure of the project a bit later, and I would like to prefer to go first into the general question and then show you a bit of the material that has made this project come into being. So this can be thought of to be the basic question that we want to explore, is that we want to look at the processuality of algorithms and how they can kind of turn into things that change the way we compose and the way we think about composition. So this idea of mattering has to do with agency, so the idea that there's a human computer agency and we will try to locate it through artistic practice. I think that one thing to understand for our perspective is that we think that algorithms are not necessarily just formal structures that somebody invents and then we can use them and we can theorize about them, but algorithms are things that are intrinsically connected to histories of becoming. So algorithms don't just come into being from nothing, but they have trajectories in which they kind of change their shapes. I have just used this graphic as an example of something that I have been using. There's on the left-hand side this kind of amoeba structure that used to be kind of a control surface for a sound process environment, just for me to observe which processes are coming and going. And then through evolution, I started to use it as something that has that is a dedicated visual piece. So it goes into a video installation, and then in the next turn, I was interested in text. I became interested in text, so I transferred that algorithm. So one thing we're working with is the idea of reconfiguration, so that you have a set of things, and then when you go to the next iteration, you exchange a specific context, and that kind of that gives you kind of a handle on understanding how algorithms work. I'm going to show you a short piece. This is basically with this algorithm, just to give you a bit of a visual impression. I had some sheep here. So this was a piece, for example, that used to be a purely electroacoustic piece. I did it, I think, in 2012. And then at some point I had the opportunity to make a more a new version. And I had been working with this type of algorithms that sort, in a way, a graph of things. In this case, this is an abstraction of letters. And I'm gonna go, and it's a kind of a dynamic system. So it's a kind of a simple algorithm, it's a physically inspired algorithm. You can see how this algorithm is used to create the entire the video structure. And what I found very interesting is that you have only a very few sets of parameters, but when you kind of experiment with them, so you have to kind of go and kind of work with them for a while to understand how specific things interact with each other. Aesthetic qualities reveal themselves that I would say it's too limited to say they come just out of this kind of number of parameters, but they come out of this co-agency of learning to use them, so of this interaction between me and the computer. Then then, for example, I took this thing and I created, I'm also interested in then moving them to different media. So, for example, I did digital prints. I did an exhibition that had digital prints of this thing, and then it struck me that, for example, these three selected frames or still images from sequence, they revealed this kind of quality that there's gaps in the aesthetic perception. So I don't think it makes so much sense to talk about the algorithm or the number of parameters. What we can see is that there's something that we could call transpositions that happen because we work with these algorithms. So maybe we change just a tiny parameter, but it leads to a completely new quality of things. And this is something that traditional ways of talking about algorithms and explaining them from a computational perspective do not address. They do not address necessarily these aesthetic qualities and how they have to do with a personal approach to using the algorithms. The last bit of the theoretical foundation, maybe just to give you a few hints of how we are thinking about algorithms, there's first of all the theory from Luciana Parisi, who is coming from architecture, and she has a very interesting theory about understanding algorithms through something she calls speculative reasoning, and as something that has what she calls an abstract reality. I don't want to go into the detail, I just want to say that there's a discourse that comes from cultural theory that is very distinct from computer science, for example, that brings a new idea of how we could understand this way of novelty, how novelty is brought into algorithms. The other one is coming from science and technology studies, especially Karen Barat and Hans-Jörg Reinberger. They are researching on how laboratories work, so how scientists mainly approach their object, how something happens in the laboratory. And I think what we're trying to do is kind of take some of these ideas and try to see if we can work with them in the artistic research. This is one of the things that I find very interesting. There's a concept that's called extimacy. So there's the idea that we cannot be separated from the machines that we use. There are somehow this boundary is enacted by working with them. There's something that we can only do because this thing is external of us, but at the same time deeply located within our knowledge and in this trajectory of working with it. Another way of thinking of that is that, so this is kind of a visualization, maybe you have seen it from other presentation. This is something that I keep using because it's for me very easy to kind of understand what it is about. Of course, you can see that it's kind of a logistic, it's just a plot of a logistic formula, but what I'm interested in is this kind of idea that we don't have these two sides, control and communication, or attention and perception. But the process is something that is kind of this exchange process of these both sides. And this kind of splitting this boundary and reenacting the boundary is that what produces actually that what is interesting. And you can exchange these kind of oppositions. You can, for example, when people think about artistic processes from music psychology, let's say, there's always these behavioral models of goal setting and goal attainment. And all of them, they kind of skip this middle part. And the same maybe is about also the question if this transcending this boundary between human and machine, if these are so clearly distinct, or if not, we become machine and machine become human. Next, I would like to show a trailer from an exhibition project we did before this project started, but I think it was kind of us waiting for the confirmation, and so it has a lot of elements that kind of are connected to what we were trying to do. It's roughly 5 minutes, so maybe I'm gonna fade out at some point. So this is again the same combination, me and David, and the third person, Lisa Horvath, she's a stage designer, and we tried to also understand what happens when there's a collaborative aspect. In this case, it's a 48-channel sound installation in a gallery space. There's also a text installation, and there's two types of video installation. And what we tried, and so the title of this exhibition was what we were trying to also plan to do in algorithms that matter. So imperfection as kind of, let's think about the classical ways how we think about algorithms, and we would then think of, for example, the halting problem, computation, what can be computed. Something comes to an end and creates a specific solution, a specific numeric output. And we wanted to kind of come from the opposite side and think about the idea that that algorithms are essentially about something that can continue and can go on and can take durations. And I would like maybe to invite you to pass around. This is kind of a catalog from the exhibition, so there's a couple of copies. If you're taking good care, some of you can keep those copies. It's an edition of 300, so please, if you keep them, take good care of them. They have also, you can see, they have individual covers. So we were trying also in a way to work with this multiplicity in different media. Here's a video. This is part of a video installation, and then again, in the course of the project, we took something that existed and we tried to see what happens when we change the format. For example, we changed the screens to very, very small screens. That's what we did in July. And what we want to do is we want to understand that what happens when you change a specific element. So it's kind of an iteration, but not within a piece, but using different pieces. So the idea that the algorithm is kind of showing itself not within a piece, but in a process that has other boundaries, that is not necessarily the boundary of a piece. Maybe that's just to give you an impression of this project that led into this. So I think what we're interested in, so then the name, that algorithm that matter, of course it has to do with mattering and with the idea of physicality or material processes, but also with the idea of making sense. And if you look into the classical literature or the classical computer art, often of course you find very opposing positions. I picked Nakhe because it's a very clear example. There's of course a broad spectrum of different people have different positions, but I think that in most of them we kind of find this idea that the computational medium is essentially about semiotics and about logical structures and about even this kind of saying is comes from conceptual art. You need to kind of conceptualize the piece. You don't even need to build it physically, and we're trying to, in a way, to say that we want to do the opposite. We want to come from the opposite side without, in a way, giving up the conceptual part. How much am I into time? I think.
Good.
I'm not sure I'm gonna show this one because it's maybe too much. So for example, to give you a kind of an idea of what we're doing now, we also. I will talk a bit about the methodology in a minute, but also to say that for us this is kind of an open-ended process. So we have this kind of research questions and hypothesis how we want to work, but in order to be true to this kind of process aspect, we are also trying to collaborate and try to see if we can kind of connect and graft on other things. So this. This is a project that is fairly recent, or it's an exhibition that is ongoing right now, and I'm going to show you a little video about that. It was the idea that, in a way, algorithms and humans are not opposed to algorithms, but humans are also algorithmic, if you like. So the idea that something is only in the computational medium, it only needs a digital domain, I think is also wrong in the sense that these things, how they happen, the aesthetics that are involved in that, they can also be used in when we work together with other humans, for example. In this case, there was a sound artist, so me, and a visual artist, and a writer. We tried to see what we can do with this metaphor of particle systems and swarming and networking. Apology for the quality of the video. This was I just shot the stuff last week, and so it's not really edited and cut. It's also just to give you kind of an idea of how I imagine that, that we have to work through this artistic practice in a way to understand what we're doing instead of just theorizing about it. This piece again has a sound installation as a, one of the core elements. So my medium is sound, so often sound is part of the work, but not necessarily alone. It's also a visual installation. You can see some network structures, some fish traps, some bee hives. So we try to hybrid, create kind of a hybrid structure of things that kind of have to do with the idea of becoming a group and not becoming, going away from the individual, but what is this idea of networking that I think is very essential also to algorithms. And also, as we see, it's a networking event, so it's about connecting to other things that might be different or shift the focus to something. It also has a small video installation, so there was a text written by this lyricist or writer, and I kind of took this text and did a kind of an interpretation in the sound by applying specific algorithmic processes to it. And so this was also this idea of giving away control that also I think has to do with algorithms, that algorithms are not about control but also about giving up control. And also you can see that we were very interested also in these physicality, in physical materials and physicality. And I think that there's kind of a continuation between the digital medium and the other medium. The sound installation, for example, uses this kind of mechanical relay structure to move the sound in space. It's also kind of a very antique technique, if you like, but also, again, has a very particular material form. We had an interesting presentation in the opening, so we are also trying to go away from saying we're just working in the artistic domain. We're also interested in connecting to people from other disciplines, scientific disciplines. So in this case, we collaborated with part of the biology faculty in Graz that is called Artificial Life Lab. So they are basically at this point of being biologists but working with computation, you know, models. And especially swarming models. And I found, if I just picked this slide from the presentation of the director of this institute that was integrated into the opening of the exhibition, because I thought it very put very beautiful. So Leben is algorithmic, life is algorithmic. So he kind of go into evolutionary theory and describe how algorithms kind of inform it, but in a way we wouldn't actually expect. So I think humans and machines, they can be in alignment. And I was even thinking about the title of it, about the, that I have not really thought about it. It's just something that goes in my head about this, what does that mean, humanizing algorithmic listening? And couldn't we also do the opposite? Couldn't we think about machinizing, I don't know how you say that. I don't know if that word exists, machinizing human listening. Because often we don't really listen that well, to be honest. So I think we can also learn from machines about how to listen in a specific way. So I want to say in summary for the framing of the project, what we think is that algorithms are performing entities, and we want to go away, we want to kind of move to the artistic research domain and want to go away from something that is dominated usually by cognitive modeling and these kind of theories that are these opposite poles. And in a way to say that algorithms can be studied through series of pieces and by comparing something that shifts from piece to piece and from person to person, from machine to machine, and thereby we kind of gain an observational network that says something about the agency. This is a kind of the sketch of the formal methodology of the project. This is for us just like the skeleton in which we kind of budgeted and made the project. We will see whether it goes that way or not, because we're just starting the first iteration, so we're planning 4 iterations in which me and David, so the 2 principal investigators, are joined by guest artists. And we also have 2 specific software tools that I don't want to really present today because there's not that much time. But we want to also work with them as kind of devices and see what happens. Can we give them to the guest artists or couple them to the guest artists? these two things are called, one is called sound process and the other one is called rattle. And I think what is also interesting in this constellation is, I think that's a very good setup, these two double team in a way, is that we kind of move away in certain ways from each other. We have kind of opposite ways of how we want to work with these tools or move them into different directions. And that creates also kind of a very interesting space. Perhaps last, I show you a little video that David prepared, who unfortunately couldn't be here. He's trying to finish his thesis. He's building, for example, a very interesting physical modeling system, a very particular physical modeling system. And this is coming from a predecessor project called Transpositions, where they work with scientific data. He has a kind of an idea of not doing something opposite to visualization and sonification by giving a structure already and then seeing how the data can condense in the structure. So giving somehow breathing space for the data but not creating the sound model based on the data. This is one iteration, just to compare. This is another. This is from simulated the human neural network data. So he's trying to kind of work with this kind of how can we do useless machines and how can that help as an aesthetic position. These are the four guest artists. So I'm excited. We're going to start this autumn with Ron Quiveler. Some of you might know him as someone that has very long time collaborated in the Superglider development. And so we go on in half year cycles. So the first, the last thing I want to say maybe is to wrap up what we're doing in the next steps. There's a very interesting congress coming up, so you're all invited to check this out. Unfortunately, the URL is not so easy to remember. But if you Google a transposition Stockholm, you'll find it. So that's something happening in the beginning of October. And then, so Ron will come as the first invited artist, and we will also go to Riga to present our work. And then in the middle term, we're going to have collaborating institutions with which we try to do workshops. One of them is BEG in Norway, another one is the Aarhus Institute in Ghent, and so on. And we're still open for collaboration, so please also talk to me if you do something that you can imagine has to do with what we're doing, because we also see this as a building network structure. And hopefully then in the very end, so 2019, 2020, we're going to have a big kind of symposium that ties everything together. And finally, please, if you're interested, we have this mailing list here. Also, the URL is not as short as it should be, but I will maybe communicate so you can send the slides out to the people. And